Good morning, students. So today we will start with session 4 of our lesson Control and Coordination. Now in the previous session we had completed with the nervous system of human being. We studied all the three different type of nervous system there. Now today we are going to carry out one activity which tells us the relationship between the receptor and brain. Okay, so let's start with the activity. So students, here we are going to do activity 7.1 of your NCERT textbook. So there are certain question and answers now, which you can perform this experiment at home. Now, put some sugar in your mouth. How does it taste? The sugar is sweet to taste. Now you get the taste of the sugar because you know there are gustatory receptors in your tongue. So here there is a diagram here showing the taste map of the tongue. Okay, you get the sweet taste from the tip of the tongue. On the sides, you get the salt, you decide the salty taste, okay, of what you eat. Then here, you get the sour taste. And at the back side, you get the bitter sensation. Okay, so this is the taste map of a human tongue. Let's go to the next part. The next question. Block your nose by pressing it between your thumb and index finger. Now eat sugar again. Is there any difference in the taste? Please try it at home. But we see the answer here for the time being. Yeah. Here you can see this person. The nose is blocked. And now I will put the sugar in the mouth. So let's see what the answer is. Now the sugar tastes the same whether the nose is closed or open, because there is no smell for sugar. Okay. Because the sensation of a food is dependent upon different receptors. Like it is dependent on the photoreceptors, it is related to the olfactory receptors, and it is related to the gustatoreceptors. Now how is it related to the photoreceptors? Now you know that your food items are variously colored. The dokla yellow in color, the jalebi orange in color, correct. These colors makes the food very attractive. Okay. And the taste receptors stimulates our salivary glands to secrete saliva. At the same time, olfactory receptors make us realize whether we have tasted the food before or what. Okay, now let us go to the next question. Now, while eating the lunch, block your nose in the same way and notice if you can fully appreciate the taste of food you are eating. So here you can see a family is having a food together, and you can see the food is variously colored over here. As I told you, the color, aroma, flavor of the food is very, very important. And all these characters of the food is sensitized by the receptors and then passed on to the brain. So now let's see the answer for the same. Food tastes different when we close the nose while eating, because the sensory receptors present in our nose and tongue receives the signal and transmit it to the brain. The brain interprets the signal and informs us about the type of food. Now, our food contains volatile components like fennel and clove oil in the spices. When our nose is blocked, our brain receives the signal only from the taste buds. As a result, we don't get the proper sensation of taste. Now, what is the inference you draw from this activity? Now, this experiment demonstrates that the taste and smell both help the brain in interpreting the food. Now, here students, you have the diagram of the olfactory receptors. You can see these are the olfactory receptors and these are the gustatory receptors. Olfactory receptors perceive the smell of the food, aroma of the food, whereas the gustatoreceptors perceive the flavor of the food. Okay. I hope this activity 7.1 all of you have understood. Okay. So today we have completed with the nervous part of the lesson Control and Coordination. Okay. So now we will go to the next part of the lesson, and that is the hormonal control. So let's start with the hormonal part. Now hormonal control. Now in hormonal control, we have to learn certain terminologies. Now, as I had mentioned in the first session, What are hormones? They are the chemical messengers. And the who is responsible for producing this chemical messengers? We have the organs in our body which are called as the glands. They produce and secrete out substances which control the specific function of other tissues. Such organs are called as the glands. Now we have two types of glands. One is called as the endocrine gland and the other is called as the exocrine gland. Now let's enlarge this picture and see. Now here the diagram number one is that of the endocrine gland. Students, can you see this endocrine tissue? Now what are the endocrine glands? Endocrine glands are the glands which do not have the duct. Since they do not have the duct, they pour their secretion directly into the blood. Now you may wonder, what is a duct? A duct is a pipe-like structure. By means of a pipe-like structure, usually the glands pour their secretions into the blood. But endocrine glands do not have duct. Since they do not have duct, they directly pour their secretion into the blood. And you can see this endocrine tissue is surrounded by blood vessel. Can you see the red colored blood vessel? So it is secreting its secretions into the blood. And this blood, since it is moving throughout in our body, it will transport it into different organs. And the secretions of the endocrine glands are called as the hormones. Now, the next diagram you can see here is the exocrine gland. Now students, can you see this is the body of the gland? Can you see the pipe-like structure over here? That is nothing but the duct. Now, example of an exocrine gland. Exocrine gland example, salivary glands. Students, in the nutrition part of life processes, we have seen the location of the salivary glands. You have seen the salivary glands are located in the different parts of our face. But by means of a duct, they open into a common organ and that is nothing but mouth. Okay? So, now let's see here now. What is a gland? A gland is an organ which produces and releases substances that perform a specific function in our body. Endocrine glands. These are the ductless glands and release the substances that they make. What is the substance which they make? Hormones. Directly into the bloodstream. And the blood will transport it to different parts of our body. Now, next, exocrine glands. These are the glands which have duct. They usually secrete sweat. That is, a sweat gland is an exocrine gland. Milk, mammary gland secrete milk. It is an exocrine gland. And salivary gland will secrete enzymes. Yeah. So let's go to the next slide now. So here, there is a list of endocrine glands. Pituitary gland, pineal gland, thyroid gland, parathyroid gland, pancreas, adrenal, testes, ovaries. We will study the position and function of all these glands. So here you can just see the position for the time being. Individually we will deal with these glands separately. Here you have the pineal gland. Here is the pituitary gland, thyroid gland. On the back of the thyroid gland, you have the parathyroid gland, thymus gland, pancreas, adrenal gland, ovaries in females, and testes in males. Now let's move to the next slide. Yeah. Now how does an endocrine gland work? Now you know that the secretions of the endocrine glands are called as hormones. And hormones are basically, they are the chemicals. Okay, so hormones. These are the chemical substances secreted in very small amount by specialized tissues called the ductless glands. Ductless gland is another word for endocrine glands. Now, how does the hormone reach the target organ? Now you know that the hormones are directly released into the bloodstream. And since the blood is continuously circulating in our body, definitely the hormone will reach the different organs. And the organs on which the hormone acts are called as a target organ. So what is a target organ? It is the organ or tissue on which the hormone acts. So here I have a diagram for it. Students, I have taken the endocrine gland here. Example, pancreas is an endocrine gland. It is secreting the hormone insulin. And that insulin, the target organ of the insulin is the liver. We will study why it is the target organ when we deal only with the pancreas. Okay, so what is a target organ? An organ on which the hormone is going to act is called as a target organ. The target organ for different hormones are different. let's go to the next slide. So here we will start with the different glands of our body. The first one, let us start, gland, that is, we are going to study about the pituitary gland. Now the pituitary gland secretes a hormone called as a growth hormone. One of the hormone we are dealing here right now, that is a growth hormone. So let us see here the pituitary gland. Where is the pituitary gland located? Students, you can see here pituitary gland. By studying the structure of the brain, we have learned that the pituitary gland is found attached to the hypothalamus. Correct. So here hypothalamus is a part of the brain, and attached to it is a gland called as a pituitary gland. And the pituitary gland secretes out the hormone called as a growth hormone. Let us see the function of it. It is responsible for the growth of muscles and bones. It regulates the metabolic activity, that is the different life processes of our body. Okay, now let's move to the next slide. Now, what are the disorders related to the pituitary gland? One is gigantism. What is gigantism? Now, gigantism is a disorder caused due to increased secretion of growth hormone in the childhood days. In the childhood days, there should be a proper amount of growth hormone which is released out from the pituitary gland. But if the amount of growth hormone which is released by the pituitary is increased, in that case, people suffer from a disorder which is called as gigantism, in which the person will be extraordinarily tall. Okay. Now let's look into the next disorder, that is dwarfism. Dwarfism is a disorder caused due to decreased secretion of growth hormone in the childhood days. Before the normal height is reached, the secretion of the growth hormone stops. So there is less secretion, I can say, because of which the person does not attain the normal height. Now let us see the picture here. Students, you can see here a person here is suffering from gigantism. Let me tell you the height here. That is 8 feet 11 inches is the height, whereas the average height of a normal person is 5 feet and 8 inches. And in case of a dwarf, you can see here it is 2 feet and 5 inches. So you can see the variation. Okay. So this is the picture showing a person suffering from gigantism and dwarfism. Gigantism is caused by the increased secretion of growth hormone in the childhood days, whereas dwarfism is caused by decreased secretion of growth hormone in the childhood days. Okay. Now, let's go to the next slide now. Now, students, the pituitary gland is called as a master endocrine gland. It is called as a master endocrine gland because it controls the function of all other endocrine glands of the body. So here I have a diagram here. See, this is the pituitary gland. Now the pituitary gland is a part of your brain. Okay, and you know that the brain controls the entire part of the body. Okay, now the hormonal part of our body is controlled by which part of the brain? The pituitary gland. Yeah, that's the main reason we call it as a master endocrine gland. Here the pituitary gland secretes the hormone TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. Now this TSH acts upon the thyroid gland, which is present in the neck region. So the TSH from the pituitary gland will be poured into the blood, and the blood will transport it and it will send it to the thyroid gland. Here the target organ is thyroid gland. So the thyroid gland now secretes a hormone which is called as thyroxine. So this is the way the pituitary gland regulates the other endocrine glands. So pituitary here, it secretes TSH, that is thyroid stimulating hormone, to control the thyroid gland. FSH, it stimulates the ovaries to form follicle, that is ovum, in case of females, and sperm in testis in case of males. So the word stimulating hormone, whenever you have the word stimulating hormone, that gives us a hint that this has been secreted by the pituitary gland. And by means of the stimulating hormone, it is controlling the other endocrine glands. Now, let's go to another gland here, gland, thyroid gland. Hormone secreted by it is a thyroxine. Position, as I told before, position, it is present in the neck region. function. It controls the fat, carbohydrate and protein metabolism. Now disorder. Disorder related to the thyroid gland is the goiter. Now whenever there is a deficiency of the hormone thyroxine, it causes the swelling of the thyroid gland. Now you can see here, students, here this is a normal size of the thyroid gland. If there is a deficiency of the hormone thyroxine, in that case the thyroid gland will enlarge in size. And if the thyroid gland enlarges in size, it causes a disorder which is called as a goiter. Can you see here, students, here with an enlarged thyroid gland? This is causing a disorder which is called as goiter. Now how can we reduce the occurrence of goiter? We can reduce the occurrence of goiter by using iodized table salt. That is, normal salt which you are using at home, it should be iodized. So we will discuss about it. How do we control goiter? Now goiter, as I told you, is caused due to the deficiency of thyroxine. And to produce the hormone thyroxine, what is required is nothing but iodine. Now how to consume iodine? Now iodine, the government has made it mandatory that the salt should be mixed with iodine, because salt is such a food item which is consumed by the rich, the poor, the entire people of the population. So by using iodized salt, that is by adding iodine to the table salt, we can reduce the occurrence of goiter. Now, so I hope you have understood about the thyroid gland and the disorder related to it. Now let's go to the next gland. That is, gland here is thymus. Hormone is thymosin. It is present in the upper part of the chest between the lungs. So I just enlarge and I show you, students, this is the thymus gland here. Now the thymus gland is responsible for building up immunity. It is related to the immune system. Okay. Function, it helps in building up the immune system. Let's go to the next slide. The next slide, gland, pineal gland, hormone melatonin. Position, it is located in the brain. So let's see the melatonin here, and the pineal gland here. Can you see above the pituitary gland, there is a gland called as a pineal gland? Now this pineal gland is responsible for secreting the hormone which is called as a melatonin. Melatonin is responsible for controlling the sleep-wake cycle. Sleeping at a particular time, getting a waking up at a particular time, this activity is controlled by your pineal gland. So students, that marks the end of the session. I hope all of you have understood about the different type of glands we have studied and the terminologies related to the hormonal control, like that of gland, exocrine gland, endocrine gland, target organ. Okay. So now it's the time for your assignments. Now in assignments, define the terms endocrine gland, hormone and target organ. Write short notes on pituitary gland. So in that, I expect you to write the position of the pituitary gland, that it is located in the brain and connected to the hypothalamus. Then I have to tell you, you have to mention about the growth hormone, how it controls the metabolic activities and lengthening of the bones and muscles, disorders related to the same, okay, and example of two hormones which are secreted by pituitary, okay, and which controls the two glands of our body. Now the next is, write short note on thyroid gland. You write the location, you say, tell about the hormone which is secreted by it, okay, at the same time write about the disorder. So that's all for today. Thank you.